Good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting of the Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Relations Committee in Session 5. I'd like to remind members and the public to turn off mobile phones, and any members using electronic devices to access committee papers should please ensure that they're turned to silent. Today we're taking evidence on the implications of the EU referendum for Scotland, and we are considering the Scottish Government's paper, Scotland's Place in Europe. Firstly, we'll hear from the Chair and members of the Standing Council on Europe, and then from the Minister for UK Negotiations and Scotland's Place in Europe. So I'd like to welcome our first panel of witnesses, Professor Anton Muscatelli, Principal and Vice-Chancellor of the University of Glasgow and Chair of the Standing Council on Europe, Professor David Edward, former Judge of the European Court of Justice, and Dame Mariette Leslie, former diplomat, members of the Standing Council on Europe. Welcome and thank you for coming to give evidence to our committee. Can I open just asking you generally about the work of the Standing Council and how it has informed the Scottish Government paper on Scotland's place in Europe? Perhaps Professor Muscatelli would like to start.
Yes, thank you, Convener. I mean, the Standing Council on Europe began its work shortly after the referendum. We've been meeting roughly every month, 6 weeks, in plenary session, and we've had a number of work streams ranging from issues such as the economy and financial services, HE and research, human rights and social protection. And there's been one work stream, particularly on the options that Scotland could scope out in the light of the Brexit referendum. This options work stream, I think, scoped out in reasonably comprehensive detail all the possibilities that for Scottish Government to consider in terms of options. But then, of course, the work was taken into Scottish Government. Should be pointed out, this is very much a paper of the Scottish Government, not a paper of the Standing Council. It is very much a policy proposal of the Government. This paper was then, once it was fully prepared, just before it was published, we were consulted on that, and particularly members with expertise in the variety of areas that the paper covers were consulted before the publication. But it's very much a Scottish Government policy paper as opposed to a paper of the Standing Council. So in terms of the membership of the Standing Council, certainly Professor Sir David Edward and myself were part of that options subgroup, and Dame Mariette Leslie, as part of the sort of plenary group, was consulted at the sort of final meeting before the actual publication of the paper. But as I say, it is very much a Scottish Government policy proposal, which we then then discussed before its publication.
Would the other panel members like to come in?
I think I would simply add that it's important to appreciate that we do not have individually or collectively a particular political position. I personally don't know the political allegiance of most of the other members of the Council, and it is certainly true that, as it was said in paragraph 15, the views of the Standing Council members naturally differ on some aspects of the analysis and options in this paper. So, but it is true that all concern share a common concern to limit the damage that Brexit will do to Scotland. So that is common to us.
Thank you very much. The Scottish Parliament has voted to support the Scottish Government's efforts to keep Scotland in the single market, and the work of this committee so far in terms of the reports that we've published very much supports the argument that Scotland is better off in the single market. But since the Prime Minister's recent statement at Lancaster House, we now know that the UK government is taking a very different position and intends to take the UK out of the single market. What do you think the challenges are in terms of the UK government's position and the Scottish government's position, and can those challenges be reconciled?
Start and then colleagues may want to come in. Well, I mean, speaking personally, but I set out here, and I think probably that this is the one point on which there is probably complete unanimity around the Standing Council. I think it was really very disappointing when the Prime Minister announced that she had an intention to effectively take the UK out of the single market. We did, our Standing Council and members of it have made it very clear in various interventions that we do believe that membership of the single market is economically, socially, and for other reasons absolutely key to the future of the UK and indeed Scotland. So I think what we now face is certainly a difficult situation. Now, I should perhaps make a few points at the end about whether the sort of route that the Prime Minister has charted is actually realistic in terms of timescales. But, I mean, it does certainly take us into the territory of exploring alternatives to what this paper, Scotland's Place in Europe, sets out as its sort of the first potential solution, which is that the UK as a whole stays in single market as probably the best solution. It takes us into the territory of exploring as to whether a differentiated solution is possible. Perhaps I should comment on some of the elements of what the Prime Minister said, because I think by saying that she would like to take essentially the UK out of the single market, and then there was some equivocation as to whether the UK should leave the customs union, although I think increasingly clear that she is intending to take the UK out of the customs union. I think one of the difficulties that one of the difficulties with the timetable that's been said is that it's extremely challenging to essentially agree a bespoke deal, which is essentially a standalone free trade agreement, in 2 years, whilst at the same time conducting a negotiation over the divorce settlement with the EU. I think most independent experts, including some on the Standing Council, have expressed the view that that is really unrealistic to conclude all that within 2 years, that we will be lucky to, in the first 2 years, to conclude the divorce settlement and then perhaps some broad headlines around what a free trade agreement might look like. So I think that's one of the areas of concern. Another area of concern is how you would develop a transitional arrangement to avoid a cliff edge, given that in order to develop a transitional arrangement, you need to know where you're going. And that's why, again, a number of independent commentators have pointed out that perhaps the single market might still remain in play as a transitional arrangement. However, that is difficult and almost impossible to reconcile given the red lines and the objectives set out in the Prime Minister's statement. So I think that, you know, that sets out, I think, the current situation. It really does take us into the territory of the differentiated solution as far as the Scottish Government's paper is concerned. But there are still, of course, there's a lot of uncertainty as to what the Prime Minister's statement actually means in terms of negotiations, because of the fact that it would be difficult to achieve all this within the period of the Article 50 negotiations. But colleagues may have additional views.
I'm sure, Convener, I'm sure that's right. I think we all know that it will be extremely important. I think this would be a view of the Standing Council, probably insofar as we've discussed it, that when the Prime Minister does trigger her Article 50 letter notification to the rest of the EU, she actually says something about the future framework for the United Kingdom's relations with the EU. The Article 50 negotiations are about the separation, the divorce, the settlement of financial and personnel and other administrative matters. But unless the Prime Minister herself or the British government asks for a parallel process to do with the future framework, as is specified in Article 50 of the treaty, the EU isn't going to offer it to her. The EU Commission is all ready to work on the divorce settlement. They're not ready, haven't really consulted the EU 27 in any great detail yet, to work on a future framework. And unless the UK asks for it, that pressure to do the two things in parallel won't exist. Even if they do, as Professor Muscatelli was saying, I think it will be extraordinarily difficult. I doubt if very much will get underway before the French and German elections, so not till the autumn of this year. And then time is very short before the 2019 Europe, European Parliament elections. And the divorce settlements will happen. There's a clock ticking on that. A future framework, even if it's only a very broad set of heads of agreement, will, I think, be very difficult to negotiate politically in the remaining time.
Thank you very much. Sir David?
I think one of the important things, and I entirely agree with what has already been said, but one of the important things is to appreciate that this isn't a world of either-or choices. The president of the EFTA Court gave a lecture in Edinburgh on Monday evening, and he said that we're not looking at black and white photographs. We're looking at a series of moving pictures, and not just one, but several. And the idea that you're either in or out of the single market, the idea that you are, that there is a customs union and you're in either in it or out of it, is to simply oversimplify the issues, I think. And the way I would illustrate it is this. First of all, in the field of competition law, which is very important both in the UK and in the EU, British companies cannot divorce themselves from the jurisdiction of the EU authorities, which includes the Commission and the Court of Justice, insofar as their agreements have effects in the territory of the European Union as it remains. And because the Commission will have jurisdiction, so also will the Court of Justice. You cannot sell goods into the EU without complying with the EU standards. You can't, and where there is doubt as to the interpretation of those standards, the Court of Justice has, in the EU, jurisdiction to interpret those standards and provide the authoritative determination. Similarly, the Court of Justice has the ultimate jurisdiction to decide how the common customs tariff is to be applied. So a way I put it is you may escape the direct jurisdiction of the Court of Justice, but you do not escape the jurisprudence of the Court of Justice. The Court of Justice case law is still there. So the idea that you divorce yourself entirely from this machine is simply not in accordance with the facts. And it is as well that people realize that before they start discussing, are we in, are we out? The question is, what kind of relationship are you going to have, and how will companies, but how are they going to work? Is there, if a company invests in one of the other member states of the EU, are its directors, its employees, its salesmen, its artisans, its tradesmen, are they going to be able to move across frontiers freely in order to comply with operate this enterprise? Are doctors, dentists, architects, nurses going to be able to look for work in other member states, and are they the nationals of those member states entitled to come and work here? All those things are involved in the relationship, and simply to say we're going to be in the single market or out of the single market, in the customs union or not in the customs union, is a gross oversimplification of the problem. And that's why I think both my colleagues have said, and I would entirely agree, that the idea that all this can be wrapped up in a couple of years is for the fairies.
Very nicely put, thank you. Now, we all members want to come in with questions, and we only have an hour, so I'm not going to take any supplementaries. I'm going to try to get every single member in, and I know there were a couple of members wanting to ask supplementaries, but you will get your turn. I'm going to pass on to Lewis MacDonald.
Thank you, and good morning, and a very interesting introduction to this morning's proceedings. I guess a couple of things come out of that that are, I think, important. First of all, and following on from Sir David's comments about the complexity of all of this, but also the comments that were made earlier around the prospects, the possible shape of transitional arrangements. It seems to me that whatever the transitional arrangements are, and as has been rightly said, we don't know where they're going, but we do know where they're starting from, and that's within the customs union, within the single market, and with the application of all these rules at the point of that the transition starts. So I guess my first question in relation both to the UK and to the possibility of differentiated solutions within the UK, is that a correct interpretation? And does that allow for, does the fact that we start from here allow in a transitional period for differentiated solutions to be developed both for Scotland and for other parts of the UK?
So I would make two points in response to that. First of all, yes, I think, I mean, and this is a personal view, obviously, as opposed to the view of the Standing Council, I've certainly written about the possibility that since at least we know where we're starting from, if we want to develop a transitional arrangement because to avoid falling off a cliff edge, then actually for the whole of the UK, an EFTA EEA solution is possibly the best solution. It's interesting, Sir David Edward mentioned the president of the EFTA Courts lecture. I mean, I think one of the things he stressed in that lecture in Edinburgh was the fact that I think there's a real misunderstanding here in the UK about the differences between the EFTA Court and the operation of the European Courts. The EFTA Court actually satisfies some of the, would appear to satisfy some of the red lines which the UK government has set around the primacy of its decision-making over the justice system of the EFTA countries that are part of the EEA. There are also emergency provisions regarding migration within the EFTA agreements which could have been developed. So personal view is that if things get really difficult, as they will, I think, then actually if you want to build a transitional arrangement as a bridge, actually you build it close to where you are, as you said. At least we understand what the status quo is. My second comment would be in relation to the differentiated agreement, potential of a differentiated agreement, is that yes, indeed. I mean, I think if you look at the detail of the proposal that's in Scotland's place in Europe, it is about how you could keep Scotland within the single market if the rest of the UK were to decide to be outside it. And in order to maintain the integrity of the UK market, what the proposal in here makes clear that you need is essentially to keep the whole of the UK within the same customs zone, essentially, and also to develop arrangements which allow the regulatory, if you like, side of the single European single market to be in some way conform closely to that of the UK, so that there isn't too much divergence. And I think, you know, again, if you start with the status quo, if you have UK companies that are still wanting to export to Europe, as Sir David Edward pointed out, ultimately, if you want to export to Europe, you have to adhere to European standards, then I think, you know, the closer we remain to the status quo, the more likely it is that you're going to be able to apply a differentiated solution as well. So, I mean, this is the territory in which I think additional work has to be done to address some of those issues of how you would implement a differentiated solution. But as I've said, and some other members of the Standing Council have said, it is entirely technically feasible to do that, challenging though it is. But as somebody else has pointed out, there is no easy solution to Brexit. The only easy solution would have been if the UK as a whole had decided simply to slip naturally from EU membership to EFTA EEA membership. Everything else is complicated, whether it, you know, hard Brexit is complicated. So there are no easy solutions in this territory.
The when looking at the Scottish Government's paper, and as you say, it's looking at differentiated solutions, the fundamental challenge, it seems to me, in making any of that work is seeking to operate as part of the United Kingdom, part of the United Kingdom Customs Union, as you say, but also to comply with the rules of the European Single Market. Because although we could readily do that at the beginning of a transitional period. By the end of that transitional period, the United Kingdom will have already diverged from single market requirements because that legislation and regulation is constantly developing within the single market. So I guess for me, the difficult question, which I'll be putting, I'm sure, to Michael Russell later in the morning, but I'd be very interested in your views, is how is it actually possible in the real world, in the real economy, to apply two different sets of rules without having to make a choice ultimately in some way as to which market and which customs union takes precedence?
I do think it's possible to have a parallel market solution. That's essentially what's described here. I think what you would need to do is certainly have look at the way in which business regulation is framed in the UK as a whole to ensure, the word I've used whenever I've written about this in the media has been to tether, if you like, UK business regulation to European business regulation. I would come back to this point that actually it's in the interest of the UK, given that whatever happens in terms of Brexit, 45% of our exports in the UK as a whole are likely to go to the EU. It's actually in the UK's interest not to diverge markedly, otherwise those markets will collapse. And so actually having Scotland within the single market in a differentiated solution might actually be a huge advantage to the UK as a whole in a differentiated solution. So yes, it's technically challenging. You'd need to look at how you would run, could think of a competition and markets authority, for instance, though, and this is just one aspect of business regulation, of course. That is set up on a federal structure, essentially, which looks at the relationship between these two elements. You're absolutely right, of course, European standards will evolve. But I repeat, unless we suddenly start exporting much more to the rest of the world relative to Europe, and as an economist, I think that's very unlikely, given that we know that economies tend to trade much more with their geographic neighbours, then the UK will have to confront how it relates its business regulations to those of Europe. Again, to echo what Sir David Edwards said, we may be outside the EU, but the EU is not going away. It's still there. It's still the biggest market. And therefore, the rest of the UK will have to find some way of tethering its business regulation, etc., unless we decide to, completely change the way in which we do business and go for an all-out trade war. I mean, I know there's been some rash comments made in the press by, I think the Chancellor said something around changing the way in which we do business. But frankly, in the real world, where we are going to still be trading with the rest of with the EU, it will be in the rest of the UK's interest to tether its regulations in some way to the
UK. But very briefly, Professor Mascitelli, if the UK government was to agree to tether its regulation in that way, would there be any need for a differentiated solution?
It would make actually a differentiated solution much easier if we wanted to be fully members of the single market, actually. I mean, what is undoubtedly true is that the softer the Brexit, the easier it is to implement a differentiated solution. And I come back to also this other point. If we have a bespoke free trade agreement with the EU, given that 45% of our trade depends on it, we're not Canada, we're not South Korea that are entering a free trade agreement with the EU, how would you ensure that you could maximise the benefits from that free trade agreement? That is the bit in the UK's plans that is totally unknown at the moment. We have no idea how they're going to implement that. And my view is that they're going to have to tether our business regulations at UK levels in some way to the EU.
Thank you very much. I'm afraid I'm going to have to ask questions and answers to be as brief as possible if everybody's going to get in. Richard Lockhead and then Tavish Scott.
Two questions, and thanks for giving evidence this morning. My first question relates to my experience of European negotiations when I was Cabinet Secretary, whereby often we were told in EU negotiations, which clearly involved the 28 member states, that things weren't possible and that there was no precedent for them when one country was asking for something different to other countries, and then suddenly at midnight a political agreement would be struck and they got what they wanted. And my question is, given your diplomatic expertise and legal expertise, where's the boundary between legal constraints and precedents and what can be achieved through political negotiation in terms of Scotland achieving the outcomes we want to see with a differentiated relationship with the single market?
Shall I perhaps take that one? First of all, it's not a free-for-all. So people who say to you, with political will, everything can be negotiated, overlook the fact that in EU-Europe there are treaties, there's a body of jurisprudence and so on. So it's not a question of always being able to negotiate absolutely anything, provided there's a political will. But in the case of Brexit, the negotiations between the United Kingdom and the rest of Europe, and then what might happen between Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom internally within the UK, it does seem to me the starting point is the political one. Because actually the legal frameworks in terms of the EU treaty will have to be amended to take account of the UK's exit. There will have to be a revision of some of the financial provisions, some of the voting rights and so on. So once you start opening up treaties and ratification, it is possible to open up a space in which other things get negotiated as well. And that, incidentally, would also have to be true for EFTA and the EFTA conventions and agreements if anything were to happen on that front. So to say it is impossible to envisage any change to the legal provisions as they now stand is simply wrong. When it comes to what happens, first of all, the absolutely crucial position seems to me to be the one of the United Kingdom government. If the United Kingdom government, under our current constitutional arrangements, refuses to take account of the wishes of the Scottish Parliament and government, or indeed the Welsh Assembly and government, people in Northern Ireland, then it is very hard to see how we would make progress. But if they did, and if they came with a solution that was compatible with the spirit of European legislation, compromise, the single market, the interests of the other member states, I think things are possible in a world in which the other 27 know that Europe and its economy and its politics are under challenge at the moment. So whether it's doable is a question then of time, will, detail, expertise, not making silly mistakes. But there is a space where things could be negotiated with skill and goodwill. And anyone who says that's impossible for a legal reason is probably wrong.
That's really helpful. And my second question relates to your observations as a panel on the ongoing relationship and negotiations between the UK government and Scottish government since the referendum to try and achieve those outcomes. What's your observations of how the negotiations are going?
Party to those negotiations in the panel. We, you know, the panel meets to give advice to the Scottish government, and it's the Scottish government who's party to them. So I can only speak for myself. What I know is what I see in the press. I think it was extraordinarily unfortunate that the Prime Minister should... The Scottish government got out with its paper, the one the committee's discussing today, as the first bit of the constituent parts of the United Kingdom to say quite plainly what it wanted and where it saw the options. I think it was very unfortunate that the Prime Minister's speech seemed to set that aside at a point where it hadn't been considered in any detail in the Joint Ministerial Commission. As I understand it, the paper is still under consideration in that Joint Ministerial Commission, but with the clock ticking towards the British government's own timetable of the end of March at the latest for its Article 15 notification, I find it hard to see how a serious and sincere attention could be given to this paper in all its details in that time, along with all the other things on the agenda. But that's a very personal observation. I think my colleagues will speak for themselves, but I think it's fair to say that that's not part of the remit of the Standing Council to have a view on the politics of relations within the United Kingdom.
I would echo, again, on a personal level, what the Emeritus has said. I would add one other bit, that I do think it's really important in the run-up to the triggering of Article 50 that those discussions are intensified on what arrangements might be possible within the UK. And I'm saying that because there are so many moving parts to these negotiations that unless you can at least have some traction and begin to join some of the moving parts within the UK, it then becomes really much more difficult to do that in the more dynamic environment that will of the negotiations post Article 50, which is why I think it's really important that if I gather from the last meeting of the JMCP, there was a commitment by the Prime Minister to intensify scrutiny of the proposals. Well, I would certainly encourage that because I think this is a critical time.
Okay, thank you very much. Did you want to come in, Sir David?
No, not
no.
on this.
Okay. Tavish Scott.
I wonder if the panel would agree that it seems to quite a lot of people now there's a huge disconnect, that's a hellish word, a huge difference between business and trade and politics and the process of whatever's going to happen after Article 50's triggered. My observation is that Tuesday night in Lerwick, I met the Faroese Prime Minister, and he was telling a group of us that trade discussions are already underway, informally. The idea that nothing's going to happen for 2 years is cloud cuckoo land. It's for the Faroese, as Sir David earlier on said, it's already underway, because there are lots of European companies who need to trade into the UK and do and will continue to do so. So have you any evidence, or has the Council taken any evidence on that, what seems to me now be a big difference between us all endlessly discussing things that we don't know any of the answers to and the reality of business just getting on with their lives?
I've certainly spoken, and as have many of my colleagues, with a number of different business sectors, and I have to say it is variable. It depends on the nature of the sector. I think for those sectors that depend critically on the single market, in the sense that the value chains are spread around Europe, whether that be motor vehicles or aerospace, I think they're really genuinely worried, because I think they'd see the dangers that my colleagues pointed out earlier, which is that we will fall off the edge of a cliff because there simply isn't the time to negotiate a free trade agreement that will allow us to smoothly transition into a new post-Brexit world. Yes, of course, there'll be some sectors for whom actually transition to post-Brexit work will be less painful, because actually their value chains are less integrated. So what they're dealing with mainly is, as long as our product or service is going to be allowed in the EU, we will cope with that. And as you say, they will just get on with it. But I have to say, my impression of speaking to business sectors across the UK is that there is considerable concern that none of this will be actually pinned down in the next 2 years properly, and that there is a danger that we could have a very hard Brexit without an FTA in place, as most of us predict, after 2 years, and therefore essentially reverting to WTO rules, which wouldn't...
Why aren't they saying that more forcibly? Why aren't they saying that's jobs in every part of the United Kingdom?
Well, that's interesting. I mean, I think some of them are. I mean, if you look at financial services, I think they have said very loudly. I mean, I sit on a group that is looking at a particular sector around, the City of London financial services. And I mean, they are very worried. And what they're trying to do is they're trying to make those points behind closed doors to UK ministers, who are, at the moment, the response seems to be, it'll be okay, don't worry, we will deal with it. I think this is a difficulty. I think there's such a political imperative to deliver Brexit that they're trying to do this behind closed doors. But I do think, my impression is that, with the exception of those sectors who will feel they won't be affected, those that will be, like financial services, etc., are making these points loud and clear behind closed doors.
Hamilton.
Can I take you back to the conversation about EEA membership? It would mean that have a say at the table, but we would have to abide by EU regulations. I wondered if you had a comment on how that would affect the way that we're trying to deliver the result of the referendum.
Let's be clear about how the EEA works. The EEA does not directly adopt EU law. EU law has no... the way in which Norway, Iceland and Liechtenstein are within the single market is because the EEA agreement includes provisions which mirror the treaties. insofar as there is secondary legislation of the EU that is adopted into national law by the member states of EFTA by their own legislation. So the relationship is not one of dependence. On the other hand, the undertaking is that the EFTA states will incorporate the law of the EU insofar as it applies to free movement of goods, persons, services, and capital. So I think it's important to realize that this is an illustration of the way in which participation in the single market can be there without the commitment of membership of the EU or subjection directly to the law of the European Union or the jurisdiction of the Court of Justice. But as I said before, you don't escape the case law of the Court of Justice or certain aspects of the jurisdiction. I don't know whether that answers the question. Could you?
Well, it was more to explore how we wouldn't actually have a say at the table. So it's sort of going against where we're trying to shape our negotiations, but we wouldn't necessarily have a say at the table.
Well, it is clear, and one of the problems for the EFTA states, and particularly I think for Norway, is that they are compelled to adopt legislation, domestic legislation, to comply with the rules of the single market. But if you want a full seat at the table, you can't have a full seat at the table unless you're a member of the EU. That's the short fact. And you can ask for, of course, within certain areas like justice and home affairs, provided you go fully into it, then you may have a seat at the table in the discussions about that. But your seat at the table is not assured. So the idea that you can be on the island of Atlantis, in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, but still fully part of the system, is for the fairies.
Okay. Ross Creer.
Thank you. Going back to the customs union, I think the Scottish Government's desire to prevent a customs border at Gretna is entirely understandable. And if we are optimistically assuming that a differentiated agreement is possible, a solution for that in particular needs to be found. My reading of it is that there's far more political will and more importance placed on finding a solution for the island of Ireland for obvious reasons, and that a solution can be drawn from that would hopefully be somewhat transferable to Scotland. But there does seem to be huge concern that no solution for Ireland has actually been found yet. Are you aware of any options that would be possible for the North and the Republic of Ireland and that would have any ability to transfer to a Scottish-English internal union?
My understanding is that in terms of Ireland, really the only solution in terms of people movement is to maintain a common travel area, which, as the Scottish Government's paper points out, that immediately validates what the approach could be as part of a differentiated solution for Scotland, which is that you would essentially enforce a differentiated approach to visas and right to work at the workplace, as opposed to doing it at the border. The border around the British Isles essentially would be the common travel area, and that would be secured. But you could then have differential arrangements, and that's the only that's the only approach you could take if you have Ireland within that common travel area. In terms of border arrangement for goods, well, I mean there are other examples around Europe of situations like Norway and Sweden, for instance, where Norway is within EFTA, within the single market, but is outside the customs union, and trade does work reasonably well within Scandinavia. I think these are the sort of solutions that would need to be applied for Ireland, which would then, by extension, of course, apply if a differentiated solution was offered for Scotland. It's exactly the same principles would apply, I think.
Maybe I could just take this up by giving an example. Let us suppose that there is a free trade agreement between the United Kingdom and the United States, and that free trade agreement requires the United Kingdom to accept hormone-treated beef. And let us suppose that the EU continues to ban hormone-treated beef. I don't see how you can, without some form of customs control, avoid a situation in which hormone-treated beef is imported into Belfast and then taken in a lorry into Dublin, and from Dublin taken to the other member states of the EEA, of the EU. And therefore, they are going to require some form, and I don't know what it might take, but you cannot say that you're going to have a totally borderless situation in Ireland. And once you start evolving solutions to deal with that, to avoid a situation in which you have a form of hard border, then you can discuss what is it's going to be like between, it might be like between Scotland and the rest of the UK. But I think it is not the case that you can have such an arrangement within the island of Ireland, where the Republic of Ireland remains a full member state of the EU, and say, no, that cannot be applied to Scotland.
Or you wanted to come in on that particular point?
It is similar to Ross's question about that, because Theresa May and Enda Kenny said this week that they wanted a seamless, frictionless borders of the future, and yet our Scotland in Europe document said that it's apparently a red line for the UK government to control the border. So we do have serious, obviously, considerations because of our NHS and our staff, movement of people and all the trade aspects as well. So I guess any additional comments would be welcome.
Might I come in here, Convener? I think people very often talk in a loose way about borders and about jurisdictions and controls. When people are saying things like it is a red line not to have a hard border, what they're usually talking about is the visible, in-your-face appearances of a line across a bit of geography. They're talking about not having something that's got two flags around a bit of road and people in uniform on either side of it. Sir David Edwards is absolutely correct that you can't avoid some of these difficult questions of one set of controls applying in one jurisdiction and another set in another, and you will have to have a means of policing that, controlling it and enforcing it. So it seems to me that the British government has a conundrum that it is trying to deal with, and I simply don't know where it's got to on this yet, to find a means of implementing such controls as are necessary without doing it via a geographical line that is very visible and therefore has a political connotation of its own by its very visibility. Now, as Professor Muscatelli was saying, there are examples elsewhere in Europe that could be drawn on if one wanted. Between Sweden and Norway, for instance, they have an agreement that they implement each other's customs and people movement controls. So a Swede can implement them on behalf of Norway, or a Norwegian official on behalf of the Swedish, because they have a bilateral agreement to do that. So that reduces some element of the visibility. Some of the controls do take the form of physical controls, lorries get inspected, but it doesn't happen on a border crossing. They have a town that has been designated, an office that has been designated, and people who have goods in their lorry know that they won't be legally able to take it from one jurisdiction to the other without inquiring whether they have to have that goods controlled, and if it is, it goes to the depot and it gets controlled. It's perfectly possible, undesirable, but perfectly possible if we are Brexiting, to envisage controls like that between the north and south of Ireland with points of check that happen in other ways. A lot of the things that control criminality, fraud, movement of people, but also contraband goods, weapons and so on, can take place via intelligence-led police action between two jurisdictions without somebody having to stand at a border and ask every car driver to wind down his window. And it seems to me that those sort of solutions are going to have to be found in Ireland. I don't know what the detail will be. And that likewise between Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom, if something is legal and part of the regulation in Scotland, but illegal and not part of the regulation in England or vice versa, there are ways of implementing those controls without having somebody standing at Carter Bar doing it.
Very much. Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. The Ivan Rogers evidence to the House of Commons Committee this week was extremely interesting, and he suggested that the first argument will actually be on what the UK and the EU are negotiating, with the EU wanting a sequence of negotiations, but the UK wanting it rolled up into one. Now, earlier comments from yourself, Dame Marriott, you suggested that the two-year timescale will be unrealistic, and also because of the French and German elections. And last week, a few of us were in Brussels, and we were informed that the last 6 months of the two-year period, very little would actually take place at that point, because that's when the member states would have to ratify any agreement that's been put on the table. So the two-year period, therefore, seems to be cut down to like a one-year opportunity for negotiations, if also what you've said today is to be considered.
Everybody's playing hardball at the moment. In practice, if the EU institutions, the other 27 member states, the Commission, the Parliament, all agreed an end point for the decision, but the ratification and the implementation took a bit longer. If, as a matter of pragmatic politics, that suited by unanimity all the 27 member states, it would, of course, be possible to reach an agreement a bit later with ratification beyond that and implementation beyond that. I think the politics of that, because everybody is playing hardball at the moment, is getting more and more difficult. But it's not impossible that it might suit other people to avoid uncertainty and have a ratification process and therefore an implementation process that took a bit longer. What I find inconceivable is that it would be possible to agree the Article 50 UK exiting provisions and the totality of the detail of an arrangement for the future relationship between the United Kingdom and the rest of the EU, which hasn't yet been defined, let alone ratified, agreed and ratified. I find it very hard to envisage how that could be agreed all in one period within the next couple of years. It is certainly true that the Commission is saying, and many member states are also saying, this has to be sequential rather than simultaneous, the Article 50 stuff first and the second thing later. But it's also true, and Sir David is an expert on this, that if you look at the text of Article 50, it envisages that that procedure of leaving takes place, taking account of the future framework for the relationship between the exiting state and the rest. And at least the broad outlines of that future framework, what the rough heads of agreement might be, what the areas it ought to cover and its shape, it seems to me, ought to be part of that Article 50 process. But how you get from there to the full agreement and whether there is any will or indeed political bandwidth and negotiating capability to have some transitional arrangement that stands between the two, I'm much more sceptical about, because it's very rare, as Lord Kerr and other of the members of the Standing Council have often reminded the public, it's very rare for negotiators to concede in an interim agreement something that they think they might be unwilling to concede in the final agreement.
Just one other point. I think one of the issues regarding the discussions going forward will be that on goodwill. As you said a moment ago, everyone seems to be playing hardball at the moment. We were reminded last week that the Treaty of Rome was signed on the 25th of March, 1957. and it certainly suggested that for the UK to trigger Article 50, not to do it on the 25th of March. Is that something that you would recommend to the UK government?
I think all gesture politics that suggests a lack of respect for other parties to the negotiation are to be avoided, and that's true of pretty much any negotiation.
I think one other aspect of gesture politics which is best, would have been best to avoid, is any sort of feeling that in terms of current EU residents that these should be part of the negotiation. I think that would have been actually a very good signal of goodwill to indicate that, frankly, current EU residence rights would be maintained. I think very quickly you would have had reciprocity on the other side, and that would have engendered some goodwill. That is another bit of the posturing I simply don't understand at the moment.
On that particular point, and goodwill, the recent overtures, well, the hand-holding between the Prime Minister and the new President of the United States, who's been very, very upfront about his hostility to the European Union, how do you think that's going to affect the UK's position in terms of negotiating with the EU?
Pass.
I think one of the things, I don't want to comment on that particular point, but I think on a related point, I think one of the things that Lord Kerr pointed out in a lecture he gave in Glasgow quite recently is that the atmosphere out there, whether you're looking at the United States or other parts of the world, is increasingly mercantilist and protectionist. And so actually we mustn't think as a country that, you know, life outside the EU is going to be a bed of roses. There aren't many countries out there that will enter free trade agreements which aren't putting at the top what their main interests are. So let's not kid ourselves. These are going to be any easier discussions or negotiations than they would be with the EU.
Okay, thank you very much. Did you want to come in, Professor?
I just wanted to come back on one point, if I may, and that is the question of Scotland's position vis-à-vis the EU and compliance. Remember that there is an EU certification mark, the CE, and that says this product complies with European regulations. Similarly, in the field of free movement of the professions, for example, the profession of doctor is regulated under directives, and if somebody has followed through the if the universities and the professions comply with these rules, then a person who is qualified as a doctor in this country is entitled to practice in other member states. So it is not impossible, it would not be impossible for Scotland to incorporate rules regarding products or rules regarding the professions which enabled that certification to continue. But I do warn that the problem of ensuring continued compliance does require manpower, both in the field of ensuring that the internal regulations comply and are adapted as the EU requirements are adapted, and also ensuring that there is compliance by the professional bodies, by the producers of goods. So it is a complex idea. But it is a way in which, at least in part, Scotland could continue to comply with the EU rules and its products, possibly with a special Scottish certification mark accepted in Europe.
Presumably require additional devolution of powers to Scotland to enable Scotland to do that?
If necessary, yes.
Yes, OK. Thank you very much again to our witnesses. Thank you, and I'll just briefly suspend before our next panel of witnesses arrives. Welcome back. We now continue the evidence session, and I welcome the Minister for UK Negotiations on Scotland's place in Europe, Michael Russell, and Ian Mitchell, Deputy Director of External Affairs with the Scottish Government. I'd like to invite the Minister to make an opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for the invitation. I'm pleased to be back at the committee again. And can I compliment the information and evidence gathering which you've been undertaking and the publication of your second report, which I think presents a significant and important document in the debate that is taking place. On the 20th of December, the Scottish Government published Scotland's Place in Europe, this document. And it is the government's proposals to tackle the diverging democratic outcomes among the nations of this island. It is a compromise set of proposals, and I want to start with that. They require political implementation above all, and it is now for the UK government to show its willingness to be flexible, to come to the table with a compromise, and to understand the politics of the matter. The proposals we make, we believe, will not only benefit Scotland, they could benefit the whole of the UK. The central feature is that it does not impose a hard border between the different parts of the island. The public and parliamentary debate on Scotland's place in Europe has been positive and mostly constructive. Voices from all sides of the political spectrum have welcomed the opportunity to engage with what has been described as the first credible proposal for a post-Brexit relationship with Europe. The Prime Minister has given a promise to give it serious consideration, and indeed on Monday at the JMC plenary in Cardiff, a commitment was made to intensify the process of discussing this document and the Welsh paper in the run-up to triggering Article 50, which is expected to take place within 4 to 6 weeks. I'd be happy to answer further questions about the JMC process and where we are in that. I think there was great disappointment that the Prime Minister did not wait to present her government's outline of plans without discussing them with the JMC EN, which took place 48 hours after she had made her speech. And there'll be similar concern today when the government's white paper appears, as apparently it will appear today, that it has not been discussed with the JMC EN or even the JMC plenary. Hopefully, in the next period, we will see more effective engagement. And whilst time is running out, we still think there is time for an agreement to be reached. We don't believe that the Prime Minister's hard Brexit position does reflect the democratic will or the vital interests that Scotland has. The decision to leave the single market in order to end the freedom of movement for UK and EU citizens essentially declines the first proposal in this, which is the proposal that the UK should remain part of the world's largest single market. But there are two other proposals in this document which remain live and on the table, and I'd be very happy to enter into discussion of them. Last week's statements by the Home Secretary appear to decline differentiated immigration rules, despite recommendations from House of Commons committees. But we believe that those differential rules, which work well in other places, could work well in Scotland too. Last Thursday, this committee heard reactions to the paper from stakeholders. You've heard further discussion today, and I welcome the committee's genuine engagement with the proposal. I look forward to discussing it with you. Can I finally say that there are hard choices to be made ahead? This paper recognises the difficulty of those choices, but I believe the same standard of discussion should apply to the UK government as applies to ourselves. And many of the assertions of the UK government are not backed by the same quality of evidence as we have in this paper. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. I'd like to start off by exploring the intergovernmental relationships and the JMC-EN process. Now, the last time you were in front of the committee, you told us that you would keep us informed about your negotiations through the JMC-EN, and you'll be pleased to know that I have all your letters since then in front of me. And I just wanted to make a couple of comments about those letters. 7th of November, the 5th of December, the 12th of January, you wrote to us about forthcoming JMC-EN meetings. What struck me is that in each case you seem to have received very little notice of the JMC meetings, and in each letter you kind of rather apologetically say that you're unable to provide us with a detailed agenda of the meeting. So that suggests to me that the Scottish Government doesn't really have that much influence over the timing of these meetings or the agendas of them.
Well, they can't take place without us, convener, which probably means that we do have some influence on dates. It has proved difficult to set accurate dates. We are beginning to plan ahead, but an added complication now is the situation in Northern Ireland. And it is that part of the JMC process that it is expected that there is a presence from all the member constituent parts. On the meeting in January, it was only late in the day that there was an agreement that two Northern Irish ministers should attend, and they can now attend if they choose to do so, but only to participate in discussion. They cannot take things away for decision or make decisions. We will have to, on a meeting-by-meeting basis, work out whether that continues through to the Northern Irish elections on the 2nd of March, and then in the process of Northern Ireland endeavouring to put in place an administration. We are, I think, beginning to plan ahead, but we don't get given a clear timeline, for example, on the triggering of Article 50. I mean, Article 50 is, and there's now a piece of Commons legislation passed at least, Article 50 will be triggered, according to the Prime Minister, before the end of March. That gives us something less than 60 days. Not only do we not know the day, we have not seen a single piece of paper that either is a draft of the letter or a paper that says what might be in the letter or indicates what the options should be in the letter. In fact, it wasn't even on our work programme as recently as January, and I think we've made very significant contributions to ensuring that that is not the case from now on. Officials agree the agenda in consultation with ministers, and although I wouldn't want Ian Mitchell to go into enormous detail about how difficult it is, I'm sure he'll say a word or two about the fact that this is not a process without frustration. And in addition, agreeing papers sometimes appear very late in the day, and actually having the time to go through them and to sort them is quite a challenge. This hasn't been made easy by the United Kingdom government, but we continue to do our very best to engage with determination in the process. I will go on doing so. I mean, both as an illustration of our good faith, because we are genuinely trying to get the best out of the situation. I mean, Ian might want to say a word or two about that process between officials, which goes on all the time.
Yes, thank you, Minister. I mean, very briefly, I would agree it's not so much the timing of the meetings that are the issue, but the lateness of papers and not knowing what the papers are going to cover. It makes it very difficult indeed to brief properly and to think properly before going into the JMC meetings. The other issue, of course, is the work programme. I have to say it has been an uphill struggle to get a work programme that is genuinely discussing some of the really key strategic issues of importance to us, especially with Article 50 coming up very soon. Issues such as the single market, such as the customs union, as the Minister said, we've tended to find out through speeches rather than any discussions with officials. So they are the two main issues.
That's very concerning, particularly because there was a communique issued when the JMCEN was set up, and the First Minister, in her letter to the committee of the 4th of November, included the communique and the terms of reference for the JMCEN. And I just wanted to go through those terms of reference with you and ask you whether you feel that they're being adhered to. There are four terms of reference. The first one is that there was a commitment that the governments would collaborate to discuss each government's requirements for the future relationship with the EU. Has that happened?
There is discussion on papers that are submitted, largely from the UK government, although there has been a paper from Northern Ireland, and there is now the Scottish paper and the Welsh paper. But the context of that is the discussion is usually focused on positions, and then further consideration is deferred to officials. Indeed, one of the issues I've raised at the last meeting, which will be coming to this meeting, is an update on where those discussions are.
The second term of reference was that you would collaborate to seek to agree a UK approach to and objectives for Article 50 negotiations.
I've indicated we've seen no paper or draft letter. The matter was raised at the JMC plenary on Monday with the Prime Minister. There was a commitment to intensify the discussion of our materials in the run-up to that, but there was no commitment that I can take out of Monday of any timescale for seeing the options or the document. And certainly there is, and I must stress this, there is no agreed UK position on triggering Article 50.
Right.
That does not exist at the present moment.
The last two terms of reference seem to refer to the situation after Article 50 is triggered, and they are that you'll collaborate to provide oversight of negotiations with the EU to ensure as far as possible that outcomes agreed by all four governments are secured from the negotiations, and discuss issues stemming from the negotiation process which may impact upon or have consequences for the UK Government, Scottish Government, Welsh Government and Northern Ireland Executive. Looking ahead, your experience so far, how confident are you that those last two terms of reference will be adhered to?
We've seen some movement since the first meeting in the role of the chair, David Davis. Now, I must pay tribute to him. I think he's genuinely tried to ensure that he is a conduit, both for what is discussed in the meeting to the UK government and then from the UK government back into the committee. And I think that is a role that he wishes to play. It is an extension of that role is to ensure that he does that during the negotiating process, though the ourselves and the Welsh government have raised the issue of participation in the negotiations on the issues of devolved competence. We have not yet entered into full discussion of that, but that is on the agenda, and it would be important that we have representation within that process.
Have you received any indication as to what the UK government's position is on that?
No.
No, okay. I think I have a brief supplementary from Tavish Scott.
Well, I've got a number of questions. I'll just come
right,
if I can.
Okay, well, I'll move to Lewis and then Tavish Scott.
Thank you very much, and thank you for that introductory section. When the UK government says that, and we understand, said at the plenary, that there will be intensified consideration of the proposals from the Scottish Government and the Welsh Government, what is your understanding of that? What's your expectation of that process? What has been considered? Is it principle? Is it detail? Is it practical issues?
Well, if I might correct you, it's not the UK government said there will be intensification. That was the agreement of the plenary. That is in the communique from the plenary. There's not much in any of these communiques, but that's in it. So that was an agreement at the JMCP, which was incidentally, and it's perhaps worth noting, that was the first time the JMCP had met outside London in its entire existence. So that does tell you about the nature of this process. And it needs to be borne in mind. Essentially, Mark Drakeford and I wrote on Tuesday to David Davis to say we believe that those changes essentially must be qualitative, not quantitative. It's not about meeting more often. It is the nature of what we discuss. And we have said very clearly, first of all, to the Secretary of State for Scotland last Thursday, in a meeting which he sought but to which he brought nothing, we have said that we now want to see what is on offer. In other words, they have this paper. It contains concrete proposals. We want to see what they are going to say. Is that proposal accepted? Or is that proposal rejected? Or is this proposal, should it be the subject of bilateral discussion between myself and David Davis or somebody else? And that's what we now need. And we need that in the context of saying, as the Article 50 letter is drawn up, whether it's in the letter or in subsidiary documentation, there is a commitment to say, at the very least, we will place the issue of a differentiated solution on the agenda for negotiation with the other 27. And in actual fact, even if you believe that this cannot be achieved, that would be the right thing to do, because that would place this within the discussions and allow the decisions to be made about it in there, rather than ex cathedra by the Prime Minister or the Tory cabinet. So we expect that to happen. That's what we're looking to happen. That would be intensification. It would actually talk about the detail of the document as opposed to talks about talks. We've had a lot of talks about talks. We're done with those. We need to have detail.
You mentioned putting those differentiated propositions into the body of the negotiations with other member states. Surely a first stage that you would perhaps expect is a detailed discussion within the JMC that actually goes beyond broad principles. I'm keen to understand what
I would like to have
not.
That detailed discussion, but in my view, that detailed discussion clarifies the issues that should be placed into negotiation. Or to say no, we're not going to do any of this. We don't want to do any of this. But there has to be discussion about what's in the paper, as opposed to the means by which we sit down and discuss, which has been the burden of the discussion in too many meetings now.
A central point in both your proposition and that from the Welsh Government is the issue of access to the single market and what that might look like. And I was Well, that's really the point I was going to make, that the Welsh Government's paper talks about participation in the single market, but defines that as full and unfettered access. Now, that is different from what is in the Scottish Government's paper, and therefore I'm keen to, again, to understand how you see that difference and how the different positions can be moderated within the context of the GMC.
I think there's a spectrum of positions which are complementary but are not exactly the same, and then there is the use of language. And language in this is bedevils it. Membership of the single market, in our definition, is had in two ways. It's had by being a member of the EU, or it's had by EEA membership through EFTA. So that's membership. And our proposal is quite clear. We actually believe that the EU is the right place to stay. But for a variety of reasons, that doesn't appear to be the UK government's view. In those circumstances, membership through EFTA and EEA is the right thing for the UK. They have rejected that, apparently. So now it's for Scotland. The situation, I think, for the Welsh Government is different. The Welsh vote was different. There are different circumstances prevailing. But it's a complementary position because it is some form of special status. And that is the two words that is used by Sinn Féin in their paper, which we should not forget, does not have the status of a Northern Ireland executive paper because there's no agreement in the Northern Ireland executive, and indeed that does not exist anymore. But Sinn Féin's paper in December, which I would commend if people haven't seen it, is much shorter, talks about special status. So I think all of these are in a broadly the same space. I think ours contains the most detailed and clearest proposal of how it could be done. But there are, the Welsh paper has much to commend it, and of course the Welsh paper is a joint paper between the Welsh Assembly government, which is Labour with one Lib Dem member, and a Plaid Cymru. So it has a very substantial level of support.
Yes, indeed. Looking at the substance of the proposals in the Scottish Government paper, one of the issues that was raised in the previous evidence session with members of the Standing Council was the issue of the compatibility or incompatibility of membership of the European single market by Scotland while remaining as fully part of the United Kingdom Customs Union. And one of the answers we had from Professor Muscatelli was that in order to avoid divergence, there would require to be some tethering of business regulation in the United Kingdom with that of the European Union. Does that therefore mean that the workability, the practical ability to make that work really depends on buy-in by the United Kingdom, not just to the idea that there should be a differentiated solution, but that the whole of the United Kingdom's approach to the regulation of business and the things that flow from that would have to itself be tied to that of the European Union?
Broadly, yes. And that is, I think, what the, strangely enough, what United Kingdom companies will find themselves having to do. There is a, it is essentially the issue of parallel marketability, which is addressed in the paper. If you have these two ways of operating, how do they operate seamlessly? Now, the answer to that is we both inherit the same thing at the same time. On day one, we have the same position. And then the level of variation to that position is the issue at risk here, or at dispute here. Now, from our position, we would want to keep that, would be required to keep that within the European context. The United Kingdom government might want to, and there are some indications that they might want to, significantly decrease social protections, employment defence, safety standards, a very interesting issue there. But in reality, if they're going to continue to sell into the EU as it exists, they cannot do that. Because they have to observe those if they are going to meet whatever tariff arrangements they come to. So per force, there is an enormous pressure upon them to keep that regulatory system the same. That's why this overblown talk of freedom is pretty nonsensical, because it's not going to work in that way. So the reality is there would be those things would be together. If the rest of the UK began to fall off in those regards, then that would have severe implications for its own economy. But Scotland would be able to continue to operate in the way that it operates, and of course to sell at a higher standard elsewhere. It is interesting, this issue of regulation and future. I'm happy to provide this to the committee. It's only come to my attention in the last 24 hours. But there's a statement by the United Nations Special Rapporteur on Human Rights and Hazardous Substances and Wastes, who visited the UK between the 17th and the 31st of January. And this relates to regulation about hazardous human rights as it relates to the handling and storage and use of hazardous substances and wastes. And he draws the conclusion that Brexit poses a real threat. Without a detailed plan, Brexit appears to be a Pandora's box, or an opening for deregulation and regression from human rights standards. And he goes on to point out the way in which the UK government appears to be moving in that direction. Now, that's bad enough for citizens, but actually be disastrous for trade, because there would be no company wishing to trade if they felt that there was dangers in terms of dangerous substances and things of that nature. So there requires to be an understanding that there will be a requirement upon the UK no matter what happens.
On that basis, and again reflecting some of the evidence we heard previously, if the United Kingdom enters into trade deals which permit goods, for example, to be imported that would not be permitted within the European single market, what then happens? How does that impact on any differentiated arrangements that exist?
Well, clearly there would be a major impact upon its own trade and ability to trade, and therefore that would be an action that would damage its own ability to trade. It would not per se damage the trade between Scotland and the rest of the UK, but Scotland would be observing still the highest standards and therefore doing not only the right thing, but the thing that gives it the best access, because it would be doing things well. That's tended to be what works. You know, it's a bit of a fallacy to say that what works is you slash protections or terms and conditions and you just get on with it, unless the intention is to make the rest of the UK a low-cost sweatshop manufacturing nation. They're not going to do that. And indeed, the potential for that is probably non-existent, given what happens in the rest of the world. I mean, there's a great deal of this that is difficult to predict, because the UK does not appear to have a consistent or a clear view about how this is going to work for them. But the implications you can read are, if they refuse to accept that the standards that exist, they will suffer economically.
And thanks. And can I ask questions and answers to be kept as brief as possible so we can get as many questions in? Tavish Scott.
Thank you. Let's try some facts. Did the Prime Minister at the JMC on Monday, Mr. Russell, say that immigration was the top priority of the UK government?
I don't know whether she said it on Monday. I've heard it so often that I don't think I'm in any doubt that there are two priorities. One is migration, and the other one is judgments of courts outside the UK.
But in terms of explaining her government's formal position to the other governments of the United Kingdom, did she lay that out in crystal clear terms, or has she ever done so at the JMC? I'm driving at the convener's question, but points to the JMC.
It has been laid out at the JMC. Okay. I can't say whether she did it, and we don't normally attribute individual views, so on this occasion I'd be prepared to, but I have heard it laid out in very clear terms.
Yeah, I mean, she says it to the Lancaster House speech, so you'd think she might say it to the JMC.
She may well have said it. Yeah. I may be inoculated against it now.
Well, you're probably best not to be, given it's the... Yeah, quite. Secondly, is business saying enough on what they judge to be the consequences of an exit from the single market? In a UK, not Scottish business, because we know what Scottish business position is, but in a UK context, are you aware of what they're saying, and are they saying it visibly and authoritatively to the UK government?
That is interesting. I had a meeting with a representative of the UK CBI yesterday, who was in Edinburgh giving evidence to the House of Lords committee in exiting the EU, which I was giving evidence to the EU committee of the House of Lords. They published an interesting document which lays out their requirements, and they are particularly concerned about free movement of labour, or rather about barriers to employment and barriers to trade. But I think there is a recognition that whilst they wish to work closely with the UK government and with ourselves, and that was a commitment they made, and it was a positive discussion, it doesn't appear that they're being listened to in terms of some of their key concerns. So I think they will, and I said this to them, and I've said this to a number of business gatherings, I think they need to be very clear and explicit about what will work and what won't work. And if you have a position on migration, which is the current position of the UK government, you are going to cause very considerable economic damage.
And has the, in that context, of, has the financial institutions we have here in Scotland aligned to the City of London been making that clear?
They've been continuing to make a number of things clear, but they seem to be reluctant to lay down the line that they have, they feel to have, need to have followed. I can understand that. This is such a fluid situation. But, you know, for many of them, without passporting, there are severe difficulties. But it goes back also to free movement. You know, free movement is a sophisticated thing. It's not just about labour moving from one place to another. It's about the right to go and open up branches or premises, to start companies, for individuals in the creative industries, the digital industries, to work elsewhere, and to do so as if you were going into the next town. And making that point is really, really important. And the second point that they need to make, as the whole of Scotland needs to make, 90% of population growth in Scotland in the next generation is predicated to lie from migration. So we write that off at a stroke if we do not have a free movement. And given the positive net benefit of migration in Scotland, which is entirely provable, then we also look at a decline in the economy because of that attitude.
But isn't for large business, both Scottish and UK large business, whatever happens with Brexit for them will be straightforward because they'll just set up a European operation and they'll run out of Europe. It's the smaller businesses who don't have that ability who are going to be potentially much more damaged.
Certainly if you're a major bank, as major banks are looking at the situation, as you know, they're setting up already subsidiaries in or companies in Ireland, moving to Frankfurt. If you look at the creative, the startup digital side, advertisements in the media last week from France saying you can have a residency and special deal if you come and base yourself in Paris. So that is going to happen. And yes, those who are not mobile, and by that, smaller companies and older people, not that I'm including you, Mr. Scott, in that, but older people, those who are not mobile, small companies, will be the ones who will pay the price.
When I had a mobile discussion with the Faroese Prime Minister in Lerwick on Tuesday, he said there was no disadvantage to being outside the European Union if your economy was based on selling fish. The constituents I represent is. What's the government going to do about that?
And I have sections of my constituency that is the economy is based on selling fish. I recognise their concerns as being profound, and the issues of the common fisheries policy, as Mr. Lockhead knows, did not favour many Scottish fishermen as a result of actions of the UK government many years ago. So I'm quite happy to discuss and have been discussing with fishing interests how we take that forward. The Prime Minister's reference to fishing in her speech was very interesting because she was referring to fishing being a trade-off deal to the Spanish. And I think that is a great fear. It would be really appalling if what we saw was a repeat of history. So I'm very happy to see Scottish management of waters. That is not only possible, but is what would happen under the EEA option, because EEA, you know, that type of membership does not involve fishing or agriculture.
Indeed, but the point the Faroese Prime Minister was making is for their economy is growing at 9% per annum. We can only hope to be at anything like 9%, and it's based on being outside the EU with fishing as their major exports around the world, including to Europe. So no downside.
And I have met Faroese representatives and been to the Faroes and understand that. But without wishing to diminish the importance of the Faroes, their economy is not our economy.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Richard Lockhead.
Good morning, Minister. I detect quite a lot of frustration in terms of your dealings with the UK government over what is the biggest issue facing future generations we face at the moment. And I know that Theresa May's speech referred to her wanting Europe to take into account differences across Europe and for everyone to use their imagination and ingenuity to find solutions to address how each nation's differences could be taken into account. Do you feel that principle has been reflected in terms of the UK government's dealings with the Scottish government and other devolved administrations?
No. I mean, demonstrably not. Shows a lack of understanding of the UK constitution, because the approach appears to be that the UK constitution is uniform and that there is no divergence. Of course, devolution is differentiation. There is a different settlement in Scotland from the settlement in Northern Ireland from the settlement in Wales. The Act of Union is an act of differentiation, because the Act of Union says here are the things that won't be the same. You know, so there is a lack of understanding of what devolution is about and what the United Kingdom has been about so far. And that's a problem. But it also doesn't recognise, pays lip service to it, doesn't recognise the diversity of arrangement that the EU have. You know, France has arrangements for the territories Outre-mer. You know, I mean, those are different arrangements. If you look even in these islands, the arrangements of the Channel Islands and the Isle of Man are very different. They are in the customs union. And because of the nature of that, there's essentially a de facto membership of the single market, though it's not quite the same. That's a different set of circumstances from the circumstances that prevail to other sub-state arrangements within Europe. Europe has also been very flexible. You know, if these points are put into negotiation, you know, they will be seriously considered. And there will be, if there is a political will, the possibility of finding that solution. So that is the reality of what happens in Europe. And therefore, if she puts them on the table, the likelihood is that we'll be able to find a resolution.
In terms of the other debate, which is very pertinent to this, is that relating to powers automatically being repatriated to Scotland post-Brexit, and indeed the debate over extra powers being built into devolution settlements as well. Have we had any positive response from the UK government in terms of all the powers automatically repatriating to devolved administrations?
No. There is a commitment given by the Prime Minister herself and, my apologies, a range of other ministers, which says that the devolved administrations will not lose any of the powers that they presently have, you know, which is a sort of not an overwhelming promise, because if we were to lose any of them, I think things would be even worse. However, when the discussion turns to the automatic repatriation of those issues which lie within the devolved competences, an issue, for example, which campaigners like Michael Gove said it with the Scottish Parliament would be immensely strengthened, you know, by all these powers that would automatically come here, the attitude has changed very substantially. What is being said now is that there needs to be a discussion of where those powers should go, the right places, inverted commas. Now, of course, the question is who makes the decision that is the right place, and also discussion about frameworks. And, you know, you are very familiar with the European framework for agriculture. And, you know, the implication certainly is that you would have a UK framework, so those powers would transfer to the UK, and then, you know, the devolved administrations would not then get any additional power. But, of course, the European framework operates on the basis of a Council of Ministers. It operates on the basis of co-decision-making between the members. There's been no discussion of how that would operate. So I think there is a very considerable concern about what is being said, even about powers with devolved competences, let alone, as the paper indicates, other areas where additional devolution is required for two reasons. One is because leaving the EU will change everything, and therefore there needs to be a rethinking of devolved settlement. But secondly, if these powers are to go forward, then there would need to be other changes to the devolved settlement to allow them to take place, including what we think the best way to implement these would be to give the Scotland distinct legal personality in the same way as exists in Flanders and Wallonia.
And one final brief question. I mean, clearly what you're saying there is very alarming, and everyone in Scotland should be extremely concerned to hear what you're saying. Given your frustrations over the lack of notice in terms of papers for meetings and dates of meetings and so on and so forth, and some of the other frustrations you've been expressing, do you feel that the idea of a bespoke arrangement for Scotland has been taken seriously by the UK government, or do you feel you've been strung along, they're going through the motions of being seen to listen to devolved administrations with no intention whatsoever of actually doing anything?
Well, the engagement is still in place. So to that extent, I want to see it through in the hope that it will produce the results which were promised. As the Prime Minister not only said, but as the convener has indicated in the terms of reference, that there requires to be an agreed position on triggering Article 50. And that's what we're endeavouring to get to. And it is perfectly possible to have a solution based on what is in this proposal. So I am still discussing and negotiating. You know, the lot of any human being is to be frustrated from time to time and annoyed from time to time and not entirely pleased with what's taking, but there are other advantages and other times you think it's going well. I don't see this process going well, but I'm going to stick with it in the hope that we'll get something out of it.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thank you. You mentioned that engagement is in place and that Secretary of State David Mundell was here last week. I mean, can you clarify? I mean, did he call the meeting? What was the purpose? Was there an advanced agenda? What were the outcomes, goals? I mean, where was the fanfare when the Secretary of State is coming?
I'm always happy to see David. He's a former member of this Parliament. I've always got on well with him. You know, if he wants to chew the fat from time to time, I'm happy. But he was very keen to have a meeting with Derek Mackay as the Cabinet Secretary with overall responsibility for the Constitution and myself, specifically to discuss devolved matters in this paper. I had assumed that in those circumstances he would come along with a view of the proposals that we have. No such view was forthcoming. He talked about the need to talk about them, which, you know, is true, but it didn't actually advance things very far. He did tell us that there would be a white paper on the Great Repeal Bill, and I have asked formally for an advance copy of the draft on that, as it's so important to us. No doubt at some stage we'll touch on the Great Repeal process. And he indicated to the press thereafter that there would be an LCM on the Great Repeal Bill, although the actual formal position on that is that there is no decision on whether there's an LCM or whether there's Scottish legislation, and that is the position that we are in formal discussion. Apart from that, he came out and there were cameras outside, so presumably he had told the press that he was here, and he talked to the press, and I talked to the press, but I don't think it took us an inch further forward.
Okay, it was a stunt.
Well, I can't see much point in the stunt because he had nothing to say. But I mean, you know, if he wished to while away an hour in my company and Derek's company, who is to blame him?
Ross Greer.
Thanks, Convener. To be honest, Minister, I'm absolutely no clearer what intensification means after this, and that's no criticism of yourself. I don't believe you're any clearer on what the UK government mean by intensification, pretty clear on what you want it to be. But looking at a specific detail, if we're to assume that a differentiated agreement for Scotland, some kind of compromise, is still possible, which I don't personally believe, but if we're optimistic, a key part of that is the Scotland being in the single market with the rest of Europe, but in a customs union with the rest of the UK to avoid customs barrier at Gretna. I asked this question of the Council of Expert Witnesses that we just had. Have there been any discussions between yourselves and the UK government in regards to their attempts to find a solution for the island of Ireland? Because we've seen that again this week with Theresa May and Enda Kenny. There is clear will to find a solution for Ireland that it seems to me could in some way be transferred to Scotland.
Yes, I mean, we're not party to the discussions on Ireland, as clearly we wouldn't be party, but, you know, they do crop up in discussion that takes place at JMC and elsewhere. Our view is, of course, there are very special circumstances prevailing in Ireland. Those are circumstances which, you know, need to be understood and respected. But nonetheless, if there is a technical means of producing a completely porous border between what is an external border with the EU, and with the customs union, because presumably Northern Ireland will not be in the customs union if the rest of the UK, if England and Wales aren't, then if it is possible to do that based upon freedom of travel, which has been established for a long time, then it should be perfectly feasible to do it elsewhere.
Had you, previous to its dissolution, had you had any discussions with the Northern Irish Executive or in fact with the Government of the Republic of Ireland in regards to proposals that they were thinking of, solutions that they thought viable?
The position of the Government of the Republic, of course, is that they are not pre-negotiating with the UK as a member of the EU, but they have made it clear that this is something that is a priority, and it is obviously clear also that the EU would be guided by the position of the Irish government on this matter. I mean, that is essentially where we are. In terms of the Northern Irish parties, we have not discussed in detail their proposals. We have supported, however, the initiative which is held cross-community in Northern Ireland to have that open border. And that's what we will continue to do. But it's not our place, and it would not, I don't think, add anything to the discussion. You know, we were to be involved in that, except to support it. But equally, to make the point, fairly, you know, without overdoing it, that if that solution can be found in Ireland, then surely it can inform a solution in this island.
Thanks. And one final brief question, if that's okay. At what point has time run out on this. If the UK government are not making it clear what intensification means, if they're not genuinely intensifying these options, at what point has time run out on a solution for Scotland that fits with the proposals you laid out?
The terms of the communique say intensify in the run-up to triggering Article 50 and thereafter. So, you know, intensification means a step change in the process, and I suppose we'll know it if we see it. You know, I mean, like you, I mean, I'm not entirely sure I know what this beast looks like, but, you know, what Mark Drakeford and I are trying to do is to come to a common agreement with David Davis about the nature of the discussion we have when the JMC meets next, so that we can do things differently. But, you know, a crucial moment in this is the triggering of Article 50. That tells us not just that the starting point that the UK has, and it may be high level, we don't know, but also how we've been involved in that. You know, if the UK government submits and publishes an Article 50 letter, which, you know, JMCEN has not seen, has not been involved in discussing, you know, whatever way, you know, locked in conclave for days to look at it, you know, whatever way, I think it says something pretty significant, which, you know, is what has happened with the Prime Minister's speech on single market, which has happened with the white paper. If it would happen a third time, you know, and particularly in there, I think we would say to ourselves, there is no genuine intent here. So that's a crucial moment. There will be other crucial moments which come along. This is a very fast-moving and difficult situation, so we don't know. But I think that one stands out.
Thank you.
Thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
I wanted to ask you about what Charles Grant had said, and he said it would be extremely difficult for Scotland to stay in the single market if, as indicated from the Prime Minister, that the rest of the UK doesn't stay in the single market. And, you know, we have touched on these points that legally, technically and politically, it would be very difficult for Scotland to stay in the single market. The basic point being that we would have one set of business regulations for the rest of the UK and one set of business regulations for Scotland, and possibly there would have to be customs checks at the borders. How do you think that this might work for Scotland?
Well, I don't think there'll have to be customs checks on the borders. I've made that point. But I think I've given an indication of my answer to Lewis MacDonald, where I think the solution to this lies, and it lies in the force of the European market for the rest of the UK. But I know it's not my place to ask a question, but I might gently put back to you, how difficult do you think it will be for the United Kingdom to negotiate tariff-free access to the EU, given the position they are in now? I think the answer to that is very difficult indeed. So I don't think we've made any secret in the paper of the difficulties of the position in this negotiation. I think it is important to recognise the extraordinary difficulty that the United Kingdom has put itself in these matters too. And therefore that will require a great deal of imagination and flexibility, just as our proposal will require imagination and flexibility. I agree with Charles Grant. You know, I've talked to him on many occasions in his position as a member of the Council, Council of Experts. It will be difficult. But, you know, the United Kingdom has put itself in this most extraordinary position, in which it is thinking of, you know, if I may quote Alice in Wonderland, a dozen difficult, impossible things before breakfast. So we just have to accept that we've been landed in this situation, and we did not vote for it. We've been landed in this situation, and we're going to have to be imaginative, logical, thoughtful, and bring forward proposals, exactly what we're doing. And then we'll try and resolve those difficulties, just in the way I imagine the UK government wishes to do in its difficulties.
Okay. Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, convener. Earlier on this morning, we had evidence from Dame Mariette Leslie, and the discussion at the time was regarding the two-year timescale. And Dame Mariette had suggested that the really detailed discussions won't take place until after the French and German elections. And last week, a few of us from the committee went to Brussels and we met up with a number of individuals and organisations. And one of the points that came back a couple of times was that the last 6 months of the two-year period will be difficult for discussions, because in those 6 months, that's when it has to go to the member states for ratification. So in theory, the two-year window for discussions is actually cut down to 1 year. Do you think that's a realistic assessment of the situation?
Well, I think yes. I think you have to, however, segment what's going on. There's a set of discussions to be had about the essentially the technicalities of the divorce, you know, the money aspects. Now, those won't be easy, you know, and are being flagged up as considerable. I think Ivan Rogers, in his evidence of the House of Commons yesterday, indicated, you know, that the scale of what the EU demand will be. I think the UK hopes that that will take place in parallel with discussions about what the future framework might look like, but it may not take place in parallel. You know, the best way to get a solution on the money is to refuse to talk about anything else until you get it sorted. So there's that issue. I think when you get into the technical details of what happens next, it will be very difficult to conclude it. And it's not that final 6 month period. It's also the period in which the European Parliament will vote, and they have a yes-no vote. And if in that yes-no vote, you know, it's in the last 6 months too of the present parliamentary mandate, as they call it, you know, all history shows that the European Parliament in that 6 months could do anything. You know, it's the last 6 months it's inclined to do anything. So that's a really difficult period. So I don't think, you know, and Ivan Rogers is a real expert in this, he's made it clear, and Marek Leslie knows the system very well too, I don't think that timescale is realistic. I think things are going to take a lot longer. The question then is, what's the transition? If you can, you know, if you can get a heads of agreement on where things are going, then you might get an agreement on a transitionary period. What does that look like? What does it involve? You've also got the parallel process of repatriation of legislation, and that's not a small process. You know, I mean, the Great Repeal Bill is now announced. We now know. You know, when the government has spoken about this, there will be a number of other bills, quite a number of other bills, that will deal with the detail of that. So you've got a pretty big legislative logjam, which you want to get through so that on the day of exit, which is whenever it is, you know, there is not a gaping black hole without any legislative provision. These are all tall orders at the present moment. I think even the most generous commentator says that there will have to be something at the end unresolved. Now, that would be a problem depending on what the something is and how that's handled. You know, and in our terms, that would be a problem if it means that there is a hiatus with you know, membership of the single market. And that's why we're putting these proposals, so that that doesn't happen. And that's all on the macro level. And then, convener, with your permission, let me just touch on the micro level, because there are many, many organisations, for example, who are dependent upon European funding. You can take SRDP, you know, you can take a whole range of things. You can take infrastructure funding. You know, tomorrow I shall, hopefully, weather permitting, be on the island of Ling, where there's being, in my constituency, substantial discussion about the possibility of a bridge. The obvious place to seek funding for part of that bridge would be rural development funding or infrastructure funding. There's absolutely no idea what will happen post-2019 to such funding. So even with the best will in the world, there's going to be a hiatus while somebody works out where that money's going to come from. So this begins to trickle into every aspect of our lives. This is why, you know, it is such, in my view, a foolish thing to happen. But it is happening, and therefore it's really important we try and make sure that Scotland is protected to the best degree possible.
Well, this takes me to my second point, and that's regarding the transition period. It was suggested last week that the longer the transition period, then the less likely that's actually going to take place. The example was given that potentially a transition period of up to 10 years, but obviously EU member states, the EU27, are not going to agree to that, obviously with the UK then having potentially a similar set of arrangements for that length of time. So in terms of the transition, how do you see those discussions actually taking place, and have you had any discussions with the UK government through the GMC?
No, transition has been mentioned as an issue that we will have to discuss, but it's not yet in any degree on the table. But you know, I have heard you know, an opinion of transition in some Tory circles at Westminster, which says if you allow transition to take place, it just gives the civil service and others an encouragement to think that we won't believe in the EU. So what you have to do is you have to make sure that transition, if it exists, is the shortest period possible, so that there's no illusion about staying. Now, that's pretty brutal, because industry will require a much longer transitioning period. And you know, the political dynamic of this would mean that some harder Brexiteers are pushing for very limited transition. I mean, the hardest of Brexiteers, of course, who do not just include UKIP any longer, although at times it looks as if UKIP is running the UK government, but the reality of this, the hardest Brexiteers are the ones who are saying get out as quickly as you can. I saw one UKIP MEP saying it was just like leaving a golf club. You just sent a letter in saying I'm off and I've stopped paying my subscriptions. I think that at best could be described as a naive view.
Just on that final point then, in terms of the funding, it has been suggested that the UK government's financial liabilities will be between £40 and £60 billion. Do you think that's a fair assessment?
Oh, I would have to say that I have no idea whatsoever. That is not only above my pay grade, I have to say it's probably an element of complexity, which none of us in the room, with the exception of Professor Keating, could probably understand. But that is the figure that is being talked about as a ballpark. And as Ivan Rogers mentioned it yesterday, I suspect it probably has the ring of truth. There's then the question of what you go on paying. You know, that's essentially the divorce settlement. But then you've got to say, you know, are we going to stay in Horizon 2020? If so, there's a formula for paying for that. Are we going to still be involved in things which we can subscribe to? So then you get into, you know, murky waters.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. You talked about the sort of blinkered nature of some of the Brexiteers that you've encountered. How far up does that attitude go? Because certainly in Europe, it was pretty clear to us that all the Europeans were looking at a sequential arrangement. They did not think that a free trade agreement was going to be agreed within 2 years. As someone said today, that's for the fairies. But certainly in my discussions with UK level, they seem to honestly believe that they can agree a free trade agreement within 2 years. And there just seems a complete disconnect there.
I hope at the most senior level there is a level of reality on this. I mean, transition will be required. There's no question about that. And indeed, to be fair, I have heard, and I'm not going to name them, some very senior figures, 6 months ago or 5 months ago talking about no transition are now seem reconciled to transition. So I think, you know, this does change. But the length of transition, the nature of transition is very important. I mean, you know, there is no great repeal bill yet. And we are at the very most 2 years away from leaving. That is a massive job to be done, to put in place that great repeal bill that has to come into effect, you know, as the clock strikes midnight, as the UK leaves the EU, that has to come into effect. Otherwise, there will be whole swathes of national life which, you know, nobody has the faintest idea what's going to happen, and there's no necessarily a law that covers them. And, you know, that's a big issue for this Parliament too, and the issue of how we tackle that over the next 2 years will be quite considerable. There will be even with an LCM, there will be a major workload on this Parliament to take that forward.
And on the transition that you say is going to have to happen, have you had any indication as to whether the European Union would agree to transition, and particularly to agree to transition on the UK's terms? Presumably they're not going to agree to a transition that gives the UK all the advantages that they have at the moment.
I mean, we are hearing a great deal from the UK about what they want. We're not hearing anything much apart from principles of what the response of the EU is, and that's significant in itself. I would suggest that the harmony between the EU27 continues in place in terms of what their proposal will be. So we don't know. But transition is to everybody's advantage if it can be made to work. But clearly, you know, the principle that no country that is not in the EU should get terms better than or equivalent to a country that is a member will govern this. And that will govern the whole process. You know, and that needs to be borne in mind too, because some of the rhetoric, even in the Prime Minister's speech, seems to imply that nothing changes in the sense of the advantages, and that cannot be true.
Surely
on that point, the fundamental thing that happens at the beginning of the transition is that you lose your political participation in the decision-making. So there is immediately a loss relative to the current position. But in terms of, for example, single market and other arrangements, presumably a transition arrangement starts with those in place, and then the judgment and the negotiation is simply how far and how fast those cease to apply.
Yes, that's a fair assessment of how it might work. I think the question is how quickly you could move, for example, in this business of trade, how quickly you would move to other arrangements. I noticed yesterday a significant concession by Liam Fox, who apparently now says the £1 trillion target cannot be met. And, you know, I read the Hansard of the Article 50 debate yesterday morning, and I was very struck by the absolute absence of detail of where these alternative trading opportunities lie. You know, not £1 trillion, it's difficult to find any specific concrete example of a trading opportunity that could be taken up outside the EU that could not be taken up inside the EU. And that actually is a crucial issue that the committee might want to think about, because the rhetoric around this, and it was true in the Article 50 debate, is that there are these extraordinary pots of gold which lie just outside our reach because we are tethered to the EU. And the moment we're not tethered, these fall into our hands. There is no example. I mean, the only example I've heard quoted in recent years is India and access to the Indian market because of the length of time that an Indian EU trade deal has taken. But it has been absolutely obvious from the Prime Minister's visit onwards that the condition of a deal with India will lie in the area of migration, and particularly migration of skilled younger people who want to get experience in other countries. If there is no concession on migration, and Mr. Scott's earlier point on the primacy of migration in UK government thinking, there will be no deal. And therefore, I remain very sceptical. I think fishing is a separate area where there is a clear beneficial advantage as far as the fishing, as far as the fishing community, not necessarily the processing community, but the fishing community, the catching community sees an advantage. But it is very, very difficult to find any others, and I do ask for them.
Thank you very much, Minister. Just before you go, I just wanted to check a point of detail. In your last letter to committee, you said that GMCEN, the next one, is going to take place on the 8th of February. Can you just confirm that and perhaps tell the committee whether you expect another GMCEN after that, given that speculation has been that Article 50 will be triggered on the 9th of March?
There is one on the 8th of February, there is one penciled in for 16th of March, middle of March, anyway.
Middle of March.
Whether or not that is brought forward, I mean, I know no more about the date of triggering than anybody else does, which perhaps speaks volumes. If it is, I've seen the speculation on the 9th of March, I've seen the speculation that to do it towards the end of March would coincide with the anniversary of the Treaty of Rome, and that would be seen as the wrong thing to do. We don't know. But there is certainly one next Wednesday, and there will be another one in March. There continues to be official engagement, and I would expect to have a number of bilaterals in that intervening period, given, as Ross Greer has indicated, whatever the word intensification means, it should probably mean more bilateral engagement on the specifics of the paper. I don't know if Ian might want to say a word about intensification. I know he's got a view on it.
Yeah. As I pointed out earlier, there has been frustrations with the process, but I think it's safe to say that Monday's GMC has given officials a spur to engage on a bilateral basis. And this week, that process has started. You could say it has intensified. So we are certainly making good efforts with UK government officials leading into next Wednesday's meeting and beyond that. So it has intensified.
Okay, thank you very much for that. And now suspend the committee. Thank you.